Have we got sound? Yes. Professor Dyer, can I ask you to make your opening statement?
Thank you, yes. So on behalf of the entire Commission, I'd like to thank you for this opportunity to present our views on animal welfare. Overall, we welcome the continued Scottish Government in animal welfare. The increase in animal welfare legislation and the inclusion of animal welfare activities in all recent programmes for government have really been important signals that animal lives matter to Scotland. And this, of course, includes the setting up of SAWC, the Commission, as an independent body, which is able to set its own priorities to respond to concerns of stakeholders and provide independent recommendations to government about animal welfare. Importantly, also our remit in SAWC, sorry, that's kind of how we tend to refer to ourselves in the Commission, covers the welfare of free living wildlife. And this is where definitions of animal welfare, which apply from a science perspective around animal function and experience, but they don't basis action. So we think this is an important distinction, and this part of our remit really offers Scotland the opportunity to be duration of the welfare and ethics of our interactions with wildlife, and potentially also to be able to set principles and guidelines for safeguarding wildlife welfare, which can be world leading. Animals are really a key principle for the Commission and its work, and we have defined this as the ability to have physical and emotional experiences which matter to the animal and which can be positive. So we consider that animal sentience should be given due regard in all policy making, that any legislation, not only that directly relating to animals, should conduct an animal sentience impact assessment, consider the effects on all sentient animals that will be impacted by activities. These trade negotiations and other policy areas, such as the Good Food Nation. Our remit consideration of both legislative and non-legislative approaches to improve animal welfare. The SPCA and others have put forward on the need to increase animal welfare education in schools, including in early years education in the curriculum. The understanding of animals as sentient beings should be a key principle of our interactions and decision-making around animals, and really being able to embed that into early education is critical. Overall, we consider that there is a need for a better understanding and application change methods in encouraging Scottish citizens to do the right thing in regard to animals. Examples of that might include things like choice of breed and buying of pets, the use of animals in some forms of entertainment, interactions with wildlife. So as a Commission, we think there are some very important areas to consider in animal welfare, and we look forward to our discussions with the committee and to addressing your questions. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Dyer. We've got some technical problems still. I hope broadcasting can sort them out as we go along. But I think we got the gist of your opening comments. I'd like to start with the first question. And how has the Commission created its work programme, including any involvement of the Scottish Government?
So
and what progress has it made so far in relation to achieving the objectives of the work plan?
Thank you. Sorry, I think there is the audio is sort of cutting out a little bit, but I think I've got, again, I think I've got the gist of the question. So the Commission is independent work that we take those decisions as a consensus within the Commission. We do engage with the Animal Welfare Policy Team from Scottish Government. We also, and then they provide the Secretariat for SAWC, and have really been instrumental, I think, in setting SAWC up. But they don't impact on our decision making, and that is agreed through a process of working groups and discussions within the Commission, and then agreement on the principles and the recommendations. We do engage with Scottish Government, particularly through the Animal Welfare Policy Team, but also Nature Scot, Marine Scotland, the APHA, depending on the issues that we're thinking about and we're talking about, of legislation that each of those teams are relevant to our thinking in terms of setting up our work plan, but it doesn't define the work plan. So there are areas that, as a commission, we have quite a broad base that the commissioners are drawn from, and they have their own particular interests, and they're in different sectors. And so what we have done in drawing up our work plan is different areas and arrive at a set of priority areas or key areas where fair concerns were considerable, or that it was very timely to put forward an opinion and to do a piece of work in. That would be the very quick response that we made around ear cropping in dogs, which was an area where we felt that we could say something useful. There wasn't really a depth piece of work to weigh up different areas, because we felt that the welfare concerns were clear and obvious. And so we were able to, whereas other pieces of work are more complicated in terms of weighing up different principles or different areas. So our work plan has really sort of evolved through discussion, but also through our own particular interests. Working on at the moment is setting up a sort of subcommittee of the commission, which will help define or help us to prioritise areas in a more sort of formal way. Animal sentience and weighing up different areas to help us define which areas are moving forward.
Okay, thank you for that. I represent a seafood, a fishing area, so you wouldn't be probably surprised at the next question, because I note that the Commission wants to introduce protections for cephalopods, crabs and lobsters. So what would that involve, and how would that impact on seafood fisheries?
Thank you for the question. Yes, I think that is bit of anticipated as well. I'm going to make a start, and then I would like to pass that on to Jane Anderson afterwards for their inputs into this. So that the piece of work I think that has sort of this has started from was to consider, having made our definition of animal sentience, consider whether the current rules and legislation that applies only to vertebrate animals is actually sufficient in terms of which animals are sentient and whether other animals should be brought under those protections. So the work led us to believe, and I think work's been commissioned by DEFRA as well, we believe that the weight of evidence, scientific evidence, suggests that species that are not currently under the legislation are in fact sentient. They've passed the threshold for that from a scientific point of view, and from that point of view we don't think it seems logical in law to differentiate between these animals, because they have reached a similar level of sentience in legislation. I'm going to pass I think now to James, perhaps, who was very involved in that work afterwards.
James. Thank you, Cathy and convener. So the work we did was exactly that, looking at the scope of consideration. So defining sentience as that ability to have physical and emotional experiences that matter to that animals. We then thought, well, how do you assess that? So this is the question of whether those animals should be considered in policy making and morally. And we looked at four main criteria that provide evidence as to that sentience. So one was how genetically related they are to humans, because we know we're sentient. But of course, evolution can come up with similar processes and functions in different ways. So not being so closely related is not a reason, therefore, to conclude they're not sentient, but it's one to consider. The second was about the form of the animal, the anatomy and physiology. And again, sentience may well come in different structures. It doesn't have to be exactly like humans or vertebrates. And we found evidence in cephalopods of nerves that respond to painful stimuli and that can get sensitized from previous injuries or from, say, early life experiences, and that can be affected by anesthesia drugs, for example. There's then a category of the behavior, and you know, cephalopods can show evidence of responding, particularly to injury, but also distressing situations and things like electric shocks, and they can learn to avoid that. And again, they can get sensitized to those kinds of injuries. But also on a positive side, a more enriched environment can alter their behavior as well. And then, of course, we know they have very complex intelligence, opening jars being a classic example, which, while sentience isn't about intelligence, it shows a degree of flexibility on how they respond that is extra evidence for those feelings. And then we also looked at qualitative behavioural assessment, i.e. looking at the animal as a whole, what the assessment that we get. So the weight of that evidence made it sufficient to conclude that on the balance of probabilities, cephalopods are sentient, they do have experiences that matter, and that should be considered. And obviously that, therefore, how you consider will have implications, but we made sure we didn't logic the other way round of thinking, well, we're worried about these implications, so we'll change our assessment of sentience. All that concluded was that these experiences should be considered. How they're considered, of course, could be more or less. And obviously we know other species are sentient, but we still harvest, farm and research with them. But we take that sentience and those potential feelings, particularly suffering, into account.
Thank you, James, for that answer. Can I bring in Ariane Burgess now, who has a question?
Thank you, convener. And thank you, panel, for joining us. I hope the technology works for us throughout. I'm pleased to see that your work programme includes a task to prepare a report on welfare on salmon farms. Could you please speak about whether and how this will build on the report from March this year by Compassion in World Farming and One Kind, titled Underwater Cages, Parasites and Dead Fish? Why a moratorium on Scottish salmon farming expansion is imperative? Do you believe there is sufficient reason that a moratorium on new salmon farms should be put in place until animal welfare concerns are addressed? And if not, would you propose strengthening aquaculture regulations through legislation to bring legislation on welfare for fish closer in line with other species? And I'm not sure who to direct that to, but maybe Cathy, you can help me with that. Thanks.
Thanks. I can start with that one, and then I think I might pass to Libby afterwards, if that's okay. So, thank you. Yes, and I think aquaculture is a really important topic area, and I think it's one that the Commission has, although the Commission doesn't specifically look at farmed animals, I think in a Scottish context here. So we have started to consider welfare issues associated with farmed salmon and other farmed fish. At the moment, our main approach to this, because it's such a huge area and there's a lot of work going on in this space, and we're only able to really focus on areas bit by bit, I suppose. Our particular focus at the moment has been on the use of acoustic deterrent devices, because it's for salmon production. This is not to say that any of these other issues are not, but there's a lot of research currently going on in sea lice and other ways of improving the welfare of farmed fish from a research perspective. But this was an area where there was a particular concern around the use of acoustic deterrent devices to deter seal predation on farmed fish. But there's also the impact on European protected species, impact on disturbing cetaceans. And this is a really challenging area where we have three separate sentient species, all of which we're concerned about from a welfare point of view. So fish definitely come under our definition of sentience and are given or should be afforded protection under legislation, and they fall under the Animal Welfare Act. But seals and cetaceans also have other pieces of legislation that apply to them, and they also have potential welfare issues as well. And so weighing up these different areas is really is quite a challenging, both from a scientific point of view, but also from an ethical point of view. So the issues, there are issues that apply to fish farming that we are considering, and we are still working in this area of work, so we don't yet have a place where we can put forward a concerns or not, or recommendations in terms of how we see progress in this area. Is for farmed fish, I suppose as if we increase the number of fish farms, then potentially we need to try and resolve some of these issues as we go forward. So this is the area of work we're looking at, and maybe I can, from a policy and legislation point of view, I can pass on to Libby to pick this up.
Thank you, Cathy. Yes, the essential thing is really to look at the welfare of the fish in addition to the welfare of the marine mammals that Cathy's just described. I don't think the Commission currently has a policy on a moratorium because the work we're undertaking is still at a very early stage. But the welfare issues that have been identified include things like sea lice burden, and the report that you mentioned, Ariane, gave evidence of significant welfare issues, animals, fish almost being eaten alive, or significant wounding and damage to their flesh. So obviously that is something that I expect the Commission will look at. There have been long-standing concerns about the welfare effect of stocking densities, and the treatments themselves for sea lice, the mortality rates, which are as high as you would find in any intensive farming system, and that is something that is of concern, obviously. Cathy has mentioned the fact that these are sentient animals, and there's no question about that. And all this is in the context of a Scottish Government commitment to increase the economic input of salmon farming by 2030. So, as I say, we're at an early stage. We need to work through all of these issues, and it would probably be wrong of me to suggest that we would be supporting a moratorium, because in many ways that's not our role. But I think it is fair to say we're very aware of these issues. The other thing that is relevant at the moment, of course, is Professor Grigg's inquiry. And if you look at the terms of reference for that inquiry, it's not about welfare. And this is sometimes can be a concern, where environmental or regulatory issues can trump concern for welfare. But I suppose that's why we're here, and to keep that on the agenda.
Thank you. I've got another question, different topic. I also noticed that you have in your work programme, you're going to be looking at abattoirs. I would like to hear your views on local and mobile abattoir provision. Would this help improve animal welfare, and how? What other benefits would local abattoirs provide to animal welfare?
Thank you. Yes, I think I can speak to this one to begin with, and then I will possibly hand up to give extra views, perhaps, and correct any mistakes I might make, I think. My connection is not very stable, so if you're missing things, then perhaps Pete can fill in some of the gaps. Our thinking in this area was in particular around discussions around animal transport, particularly animal transport to slaughter, and consideration of a ban on live export, which we support from an animal welfare point of view, but we do appreciate that this brings particular issues for the more remote communities in Scotland, and even movement within the UK can be significant for these animals in terms of moving them off islands. And we know from work done in Scotland, from some of the research, that it's not just moving out of the British Isles that causes problems for animals. It's any movement. And the transport is a really significant welfare problem, and it's a very visible one that we know that citizens find quite distressing to see animals. And really a potential solution to this is to reduce movement journeys and to slaughter animals as close as possible to the place where they're reared. And this is particularly an issue. I think we've had some representation from farmers and vets working in some of the more remote islands like Orkneys. But I think there's also a consideration. So from an animal transport point of view, mobile slaughterhouses or slaughterhouses that are small local abattoirs that can slaughter animals very close to their rearing location is going to be valuable. But the concern is that how other aspects of animal welfare and indeed some of the environmental impacts of slaughterhouses. And this is an area that there's not a huge amount of research at the moment, but it is starting to be an area that people are thinking about in terms of the ability slaughterhouses to provide suitable stunning, for example, and suitable lairage. And they only have relatively small numbers of species, or they may have multiple different species being slaughtered in the abattoirs. So I think there are a number of considerations that we need to think about. We need to think about animal welfare in the round, essentially, in terms of not only the shortening transport journeys, but also what's the end of life experience for animals in these different approaches. So I think in general, it seems like a useful solution to reducing animal transport and improving welfare that way. But I think we still need to know more about the animal's experience at the end of life in these different environments. Pete, I don't know whether you want to add anything else, or I have some additional views to express.
Hi. Hello. Fine. Thanks for the question. Thanks, Kathy, for passing that forward. The main points were covered there. Journey length is something that people very much think about in terms of the animal experience, and there's quite a bit of work at the moment to ask whether the sea crossing part of a journey in a container actually counts as part of the journey length. So that's an important consideration as well. The experience the animal receives at the end of its life is very important. It's not just the journey to the abattoir, it's the conditions at the abattoir. So a mobile abattoir system, and it's not just a facility, it's a whole system, would need to provide the same welfare care for the animal as it currently experiences in a large abattoir that's possible to where it's possible to offer all the benefits of good handling and oversight. So that's very important. So the care of the animals is the key thing, but also there's a lot of concern about the infrastructure needed at the site of the mobile abattoir. So it's a considerable undertaking to provide power, water, drainage, removal of materials. So quite a big question. And as Kathy said, that there's not been a lot of work in this area, and it's one of the things that's on SAWC's radar, but we haven't done any particular work about this yet, I'm afraid.
Okay, thank you, Pete. I've got questions from Alistair and Jim, but Rachel, do you have a supplementary on this point?
Thank you, Convener. It's just a very small supplementary on the points that have been made there about the practicalities of moving animals. And I think it was Libby had said, or Kathy had said, that it was a difficult thing not to do, to get animals from, say, Orkney to wherever they're going, perhaps in the rest of the UK. How does the Animal Welfare Commission look at this? And this is what Pete's made his point. How are you actually going to look at ensuring that we have shortened food supply chains when somebody is not finishing an animal in the north and it needs to go to lower land? How are you actually doing that? Are you doing it from the animal point of view, or are you doing it from kind of a food supply chain point of view, which we all advocate, a shorter food supply chain? Sorry, it's a very long question, but can I maybe put it to Pete?
Yes, thank you. Well, that question sort of overarches quite a lot of what we do, to be honest. I think our priority must be looking at the animal welfare aspects as a priority. But there's a difficulty here as well, because actually sometimes you're trading off one animal welfare harm or benefit for a different type of harm or benefit. So an overall cost-benefit analysis is something that needs to be done. So we can't look at a particular aspect of, let's say, the whole transport to slaughter process on its own. We need to look in the round. And there are a number of frameworks to do this. The five animal welfare domains model is one way to do this. But at the end of the day, while we can be supplied with a lot of scientific information, there is an element of judgment to make to see what, given contemporary understanding, what's the best solution. And it may be counterintuitive as well. But we try to bring all the evidence on board, but sometimes it's not solely based on scientific principles. There's an element of expert judgment, if you like, that comes into play.
Thank you for that. Can I move on to Dr. Allen, please?
And thank you very much, convener. I want to preface these remarks by saying I appreciate the importance of what you do as a committee, and I'm fully signed up to the principles of animal welfare on which you're based, and indeed on much of what you're reporting to us. However, representing an island constituency where fishing is important, where creeling is important, I think people are curious to know where your recommendations about crabs and cuttlefish and so on are leading. Obviously, I understand why independently you have to come to the views that you come to about sentience, but what is it you're expecting people to do? Are you expecting or looking for behaviour to change in terms of how people cope with bycatches, how people cope with creels? What is it that you would like us to do to improve the lot of a crab?
Who would like to take that question?
Thank you. I can start on this one, and then any of my colleagues who wish to add in, I'm sure, can make their opinions known and their views known as well. Broadly speaking, what our work shows is that the same considerations that are given to fin fish, to vertebrate fish, should also be given to cephalopods and the decapod crustacea, because from a scientific point of view, from an ethical point of view, there is not really evidence that they should be treated differently. That is our recommendation from a welfare perspective. Now, of course, we understand that communities have many competing issues and the same is true. And I think this is the point that Pete was making as well, is our job is to provide advice based on animal welfare. Obviously, that we might make some recommendations. I do appreciate that for some of these communities that this will involve or potentially could involve changed behaviour in terms of how you deal with these species. So we appreciate that can be challenging and difficult for those communities. But I suppose our view is that the scientific and the sort of ethical reasoning that we have applied to these things suggests that these animals aren't particularly different from finfish, and so any legislation that is and wild capture of fishing should also apply to these other species. I don't know whether any of my other colleagues want to add anything, Libby or James. Libby, please.
Yes, thank you very much, Cathy. I think what we must consider is the bar is thought to be met with regard to sentience of these animals. What is the effect of that? The recommendation that they should come under the protection of the Animal Health and Welfare Act, Scotland Act 2006. Now, Section 16 of that Act defines protected animals. Currently, it defines them as vertebrates. And it allows the Scottish ministers to extend that definition to invertebrates, so long as they have evidence that they are capable of experiencing pain and suffering. And the Scottish the Commission obviously has established to its own satisfaction that they can. But what does that mean in practical terms? It means that they have the same protection under the law as other wild animals when they come under the control of man, or other farmed animals, or animals that are harvested. The protection that is given them is protection from unnecessary suffering, what we would normally consider to be cruelty. The Act also contains exceptions for anything done in the course of fishing, so that may give you some reassurance. But if you think of the practical effect on lobsters and crabs, octopus, once they come under the control of man, i.e. they're in captivity or they're about to be killed, the practical impact would be something like killing methods. And there is widespread opposition to boiling lobsters and crabs alive. And that is something where there are alternative methods of killing these animals, which are arguably more humane. And this has been applied in other jurisdictions. New Zealand, for example, there's much more guidance, and there are other methods of doing it. The keeping of animals. A few years ago, there was a case in England about lobsters being displayed in a supermarket wrapped in cling film. Now, these were live animals wrapped in cling film for a number of days. This is the sort of thing that would be the first object of this sort of legislation. So it's preventing unnecessary suffering once they're given equivalent protection under the 2006 Act. So does that sound more proportionate to you?
That's very helpful. I mean, I suppose one of my questions was really about species where the only practical method really of getting them to market might be to get them to market live. So, I mean, for instance, prawns are the obvious example there. Again, I mean, the example you give of the supermarket, I think people can readily understand that. But obviously there is an anxiety, you know, which will be expressed, you know, in communities perhaps whose whole economic model is based on getting, say, prawns live to market. So, you know, is what you are saying about some species like crabs, for instance, does that have an impact on that kind of trade?
Legislation, assuming it is accepted into legislation, and then the practical effect would need to be worked out, but it would be done, I'm quite sure, with stakeholders. And this notion of unnecessary suffering, clearly a very debatable issue, but it is generally accepted that farming or the harvesting of wild animals is a reasonable purpose, providing food for people. So we may have personal views about what's acceptable to do to an animal, but when the legislation comes in, it would be taking a much broader brush.
Okay, thank you very much. That's very helpful.
Did James Yates want to come in on that?
I think the large points have been covered very well. It's worth pointing out our conclusions so far have been about cephalopods, so octopus and similar species, rather than decapods, but similar approach one would take to deciding whether they are due moral consideration within the policy making. And then, as Libby says, what that consideration looks like can take into account the wider factors, some of which might be trade-offs, as Pete was talking about earlier. But of course, in other cases, we might well expect that concern for animal welfare is aligned with other sustainable or development concerns, particularly thinking in the long term, or of course in relation to health matters. So that's all further work to be done. At this point, it's just making sure we don't logic the other way around and thinking we won't consider their sentence because of those potential impacts. We need to recognise that, and then we can work out what's proportionate and reasonable and sensible.
Thank you. Can I move on to a question from Jenny before moving back to Ariane?
Thank you, Convener, and thank you, panel. I just wanted to pick up on what Dr. Goddard was saying around trade-offs and local wisdom and how you incorporate that into your research. And I'm also interested, it was touched on earlier under Ariane's questions about the Russell Griggs regulation review and what, basically, how are you engaging with that?
Who wants to take that?
So I think the first part was Pete Goddard.
Okay, so thank you for the question. So thinking about trade-offs, this is a difficult area, and I'm sure that's why you asked. So we can look at different aspects of animal welfare and think that there might be trade-offs for one welfare benefit against another. For example, in any production system, you could think of something quite simple, perhaps in the upland setting, of a trade-off an animal might want to make between, let's say, housing and the quality of food it's provided with. That's a difficult one, perhaps, to assess from a scientific perspective, but there are the ways you could approach that. So there are trade-offs of animal welfare internally, if you like. But then there are also trade-offs in terms of animal welfare versus societal needs, producer needs, public needs. And in a way, that's something that sort of that brings in a wider constituency beyond the Animal Welfare Commission. So I would primarily see our view, our role as providing evidence with the former, and then it's more a political and public debate about trade-offs for with animal welfare against some other priority. And I think obviously that's where policymaking has a role. It's its prime role in a way, and that's where we can provide advice and support, but with the animal welfare hat on, if you like.
Thank you. Can I maybe make it slightly more specific? I read some evidence from a piece of research done by Thompson and others talking about seal blinds and false-bottomed nets which reduce water flow, and then that may also impact on the health of the fish. So trying to, on one hand, provide protection from the seals, but then the solution perhaps doesn't help the welfare of the fish. That was kind of what I was getting at. Does that make sense? Mm-hmm.
Well, I think Cathy's going to take that to start.
Yes, thank you. Yes, I'm involved in the work on aquaculture. No, you're absolutely right. I think that we can propose solutions or potential ways of improving the management of fish that might exclude seals, but we do need to take that in the round with some of the other impacts. And I think there was a question about, I think part of the question was about local knowledge. And I think it's important to, in our way of working, that we don't rely entirely on the published scientific literature, particularly in areas where there isn't a lot of information. And I think the sort of farmed fish wildlife conflict is a really good example of that. And actually what we have done, and we do in most of our working groups, is we also take evidence from stakeholders. So we ask people with a vested interest in these industries what their views are, as much as looking at what's in the scientific literature. The work from looking at seals and fish farming, we have consulted quite widely. We've had some really, really helpful feedback from the salmon producers organisations, from the British Trout Association. We've spoken quite widely to other stakeholders, because a lot of that understanding of how these things are managed in practice is something that's not available in the scientific literature. So although I think we have talked quite a bit about our use of science and scientific evidence here, and that is really important in what we do, particularly around things like understanding animal sentience, we are aware that a lot of that there's a lot of useful and valuable expertise and knowledge that's actually in the hands of producers as well. And so we're really keen to capture that. And I think it is the seal fish farming issue is a really challenging but example of this, that as with with terrestrial animals, if you want to keep a predator out, you start with the barriers. How do we keep the predators away from the animals? And that is the approach that the fish farms are taking. But there are particular challenges in aquatic environment that they are working with, and we're very aware that the producers are working on this themselves as well, and that interaction with the producers has been really beneficial in helping us to understand, and will be taken into account in our recommendations and our guidance and our thinking about what are the possibilities. And the stakeholders have given us some really useful information, both in terms of their unpublished data, their videos, their images of what happens on the farms as well. And we've taken all that into consideration.
Thank you.
Thank you. Can we move on to questions from Ariane, please?
Thank you, Convener. So we're moving on to the theme of Scottish Government, the Programme for Government, commitments on animal welfare. So the 2021 to 22 Programme for Government, as well as the shared policy programme with the Scottish Greens, includes many commitments on or related to animal welfare, including strengthening controls on sea lice, wrasse and fish escapees from fish farms, considering whether the Scottish SPCA should be given extra powers to investigate wildlife crime, and exploring the introduction of a public register of species licences. I'd like to hear from you about how SOC could support areas of legislative policy development set out in the Programme for Government and Shared Policy Programme, and whether those announcements have made or will make any impact on your work programme. And I realise that that's a very big question, so maybe high-level response would be welcome.
Who wants to take that first?
Thank you. I think Libby tends to take on our legislative questions as first call. I think potentially also we might then go to Paula, particularly for comments around or for parts of the programme around the importation and trade in dogs. So maybe Libby first.
Thank you. First of all, with regard to the consultation or the task force for the Scottish SPCA, it's something I do have a view on. It's an enforcement issue. This is my own opinion, which is that any additional resource to combat wildlife crime is to be promoted and encouraged. However, with my SOC hat on, and I'm not sure what other colleagues would think, but I'm not certain that we would be involved in that directly. It is certainly a policy and enforcement issue I'm keenly interested in, but unless Cassie thinks otherwise, or unless it's referred to the Commission, which could happen, I'm not terribly sure that our sort of advice could usefully input there. On species licensing, this is an area which is so large. It springs from conservation, obviously, in the Wildlife and Countryside Act and licensing under Section 16 of that Act. There has been challenges to things like the general licenses for the taking and killing of wild birds, and those have taken place south of the border, but there has been an impact that's been felt up here. And the test for issuing a species license, whether it's a specific license for control of a protected animal or a general license for the more widespread, the stoats, the corvids, the pigeon, the test for that is that there has to be no other suitable alternative. And in looking at those tests, I think the Commission, again, speaking from my own point of view, but I think the Commission would be keen to see more attention to the welfare aspects in that. It's not within the legislation at present, but it's clear that the licensing authorities and Scottish Government are keenly interested in welfare and want to make that one of the principles by which they act. In terms of wildlife management more generally, I think it's also in the PFG, or it's certainly been spoken about previously, in that a strategic approach to wildlife management is being proposed with principles attached for management. And again, the Commission has yet to discuss this in detail, but I think we would be keen to see ethical principles, welfare-based principles built in to that approach. That's both to wildlife management under licence and not under licence. And I do apologise, I can't remember what the third part of that question was. Can you remind me?
Well, I was giving examples, and I was talking about the strengthening controls on sea lice, wrasse and fish escapees, but it was really generally to get a sense of, whether the PFG and the shared policy programme, what the announcements within the PFG, what kind of impact it would have on your work programme, and I think you've begun to outline that. But yes, if you wanted to talk a little bit about the controls on sea lice, wrasse and fish escapees from fish farms. But we've kind of already touched quite a bit on fish farms already.
Yes. I'm not very sure whether the aquaculture subgroup, and Cathy can keep it right here, has looked at the use of cleaner fish. But again, there are welfare issues surrounding it. And I suppose one would be in that there's population and conservation issues as well as to where these fish are taken from. But there are issues of their welfare and what happens to them at the end. Are they allowed simply to die off from starvation, or are they culled once the salmon population has been harvested? But it's not one of the groups that I'm on, so I'll pass back to Cathy on that one.
Thank you, Libby.
Thanks, Libby. Cleaner fish was on our list of things to look at, and I think concern around the licensing of ADD, so the acoustic deterrent devices that they asked for our help with that, which turned out to be quite a substantial issue for us to deal with, but also helped us set some ethical principles, ethical frameworks in place that we can then apply to other issues. So I think the cleaner fish will come back on our radar once we have worked through the issues with salmon. There's only, I guess, so many things that we can do, and there's quite a lot of sort of fairly urgent, some urgent, some sort of longer term to deal with. I think when we get to those is a bit harder to say sometimes. Often we start with what we think is quite a focused question, but it does tend to be quite substantial and take some work to get through that, particularly when there are a lot of competing interests that we would like to take into account. I think there was a broader question about how the programme for government might shape our work plan. I think it is something that we consider, and we tend to look at our work plan. We meet as a whole commission, and we look at our work plan every time that we meet together, and so there are adjustments to the work plan, and the things coming up in the programme for government where we feel that there is a need for us to make a statement or recommendations, or whether we are specifically asked by Scottish Government or one of the agencies to help with something, then that would be, it doesn't necessarily mean that we will do that, but it's something that we would discuss in the plenary sessions to decide whether that is something that we should be focusing on.
Thank you. Thank you, Peter.
Can I bring in Paula Boyden? I think she wanted to make a contribution.
Yes, thank you very much. It's really to follow up on Cathy's comments, just really in terms of the PFG and the aspect to work with the other governments to look at managing the importation of dogs. As an individual who works across other administrations, sometimes there are benefits in working individually. So, for example, with Scottish Government introducing regulation of animal welfare establishments, that's really helpful for me because I can use that with the other administrations. But I think in terms of importation, it is important that we are working across the board to make sure that we have a consistent approach to importation of dogs. I think one thing I would say is there is a broader issue there, and I think it's something that the Commission can contribute in that clearly the importation of dogs is very much associated with the supply and demand of dogs, which is a broader issue. You'll be very aware that the Kept Animals Bill is going through Westminster at the moment, and Scottish Government is progressing with a legislative consent as part of that. I think now is the time to actually take a step back and take a holistic view of supply and demand. In terms of the demand, we know, for example, Scottish SPCA are running their campaigns to try and look at the consumer side of things, but from a legislative perspective, we need to look at where the gaps are. So, for example, one of the recent introductions with the new licence of activities involving animals introduces Lucy's Law, which is a ban on third-party sales, which is quite appropriate. What I have seen, if I might for one moment put my my day job hat on, is that we have seen an increase in the importation of heavily pregnant female dogs into the country, because it circumvents that, because you then have a mum and her pups to be able to sell the pups. So we do need to look at that. The other a key, I think, gap for us is traceability of dogs, and I think until we have that traceability, there are opportunities, unfortunately, for those that are involved in this activity purely to make money. So I think there is a great opportunity for the Commission to identify those gaps and be able to enter into a dialogue with Scottish Government about how and where those gaps could be plugged.
Thank you, Paula. That's helpful. That takes us neatly on to our next theme, which is around other UK legislation. So if I could bring in Jim Fairley, please.
Sorry, where are we? I was writing down the... Yes, it was... I just wanted to... Is it the...
Yeah.
EU?
The question eight you said you had.
Question eight, convener. It was the view on animal welfare regulation being made UK-wide and being done at a UK level. Do you have any views on the implications for the engagement of Scottish stakeholders in the UK-wide legislation in devolved areas? My apologies, I was on the following preceding page, I should say.
Thank you. Yeah, I can make a start on that, and then Paula may also want to come back in again, I think particularly in the trade for... and other animals coming into the country. I think, I think where we have these proposed changes in legislation, particularly around trade and movement of animals, it is difficult and challenging to have animal welfare legislation which differs in different parts of the UK. And I think I'm sure, and Paula will talk to this much more eloquently than I, about the ways that people will try and circumvent any legislation. So if we have legislation in the UK, the animals will come in through a different route. I think that's true potentially also of farmed animals as much as it is of the trade in pets, but I'll speak to that as well.
Thank you. Yes, thank you, Cathy. Certainly with importation, I think one of the challenges we have is that the points of entry. So clearly we know that, for example, importation of dogs, a lot of dogs are coming in through the ports in the southeast of England, but they will end up in Scotland. So actually having legislation that is the same across all of the administrations certainly will enhance our ability to be able to deal with these issues. It's something I don't feel that we can deal with at a devolved level in terms of having differences. And I think it's in terms of encouraging stakeholders in the devolved nations, this is one of those areas I feel that we do have to look at holistically. One thing we have found with, again, if I might just put my day job hat on for a moment, we've been working in the area of illegal importation of puppies into the UK for many years. And what we have found is that those involved in this activity are very, very quick and very good at changing the way that they operate. So to give you an example, we know that a lot of puppies were illegally imported into the UK through the pets travel scheme, through non-commercial routes. When we went into lockdown due to COVID restrictions, there was an almost overnight swap to using commercial routes for that. So I think it's really important we don't underestimate the ability of the individuals involved in these activities, and any nuances between legislation could certainly give them an opportunity for a potential loophole.
Can I just clarify, what is the position UK-wide in terms of dog chipping? I know that all my dogs have all had to be chipped. So what is the UK-wide position on that?
So the UK-wide is it's mandatory across all administrations to microchip a dog. You may be aware that there is certainly proposals, particularly south of the border, to introduce mandatory microchipping of cats at the moment. However, there are challenges with the way that the system is currently run. So, for example, when compulsory microchipping was introduced back in 2016, there were 4 databases. We are now up to 16 databases. There is no easy way to access the information in those across those databases. There's no single point of contact. So until that is resolved, one has concerns about introducing further compulsory activities. The other aspect from my perspective, and forgive me, I'm speaking about the situation south of the border here, but in terms of penalties, if somebody has a dog that's not microchipped, they're given a window to basically microchip that dog. What we need is sort of immediate on the ground penalties to actually act as an incentive to encourage dog owners to get their dogs microchipped. So there's a lot that could be done to tighten that legislation up, and it does make sense to have parity across all administrations. You may recall when this legislation was going through that Westminster and Wales had drafted their legislation separately, and the initial drafts completely contradicted each other. So that's why, again, it's really important that the administrations are talking to each other to make sure that we've got good, solid, robust, enforceable legislation.
One of the points they just made there is actually one that I came across myself. I had a dog that went to another farmer, and they couldn't find the chip. The dog was chipped. I had all the paperwork and everything. But as you say, there were only 4 databases at that point. If we're now up to 16, then surely the ability to be able to track dogs is one of the things I was looking at here. The ability to track them is going to be essential to be able to go forward. If we've now got 16 databases, how can we possibly tie that down?
That's a really good question, and this is one of the areas of frustration that there is no single point of contact. When back in the day of 4 databases, there was a proposal to have a single point of contact for those. Unfortunately, that didn't happen. But it means that, if I may, my professional qualification is as a vet. If I'm standing in a consulting room with a stray dog that's been brought in, the potential is I have to try and contact 16 databases to try and find the owner for that. So I think that they need to be tied up. The other challenge that we have is if there is that there is no robust guidance to deal with any sort of keepership disputes either. So the databases are the ones that are clearly they're running a business, and I think that there needs to be a good robust process of being able to deal with things like keepership disputes.
Okay, I've got one very final point, if that's okay. I'm presuming that the still the biggest market for where pups are being bred or pregnant bitches are being produced is still in Ireland that are coming over. But I also know that there is reasonably good trade between Ireland and the rest of the UK with working sheepdogs. Do you have a view on whether or not sheepdogs should be transferable between Ireland and the rest of the UK?
In terms of dogs in general, that there are routes to be able to move those dogs across, but clearly as with Ireland being an EU member state, the UK no longer being part of the EU, they would need to go through the appropriate channels in order to do that. The other quite significant source of dogs from Ireland is actually racing greyhounds. So over 80% of the greyhounds that are racing in Great Britain are bred originally in Ireland. Those transport routes are there. I think that the challenge that we have is obviously in terms of the island of Ireland, we have the Republic, which is part of the EU. We have Northern Ireland, which is part of Great Britain. I appreciate this is not the forum to discuss the challenges with that, but there are certainly significant challenges in terms of the routes used and the mechanisms to actually, in terms of passports, do you need a passport? Do you not? The other comment I would just make about microchipping and in terms of traceability is we, as you would be aware, that we have during lockdown seen a reported increase in theft of pets, particularly dogs. And certainly, again, with the cat side of things, if we are looking at microchipping cats, we do need to be able to have that traceability. So, for example, with a cat, has it been stolen? Has it been run away? Has it been hit by a car? So there are broader issues with microchipping, and certainly the theft side of things is one of them.
Okay, thank you.
Before I bring in Ariane with her question on this theme, did James Yates, did you have something you wanted to come back in on?
It was to broaden it into cats, though Paula picked that up at the end, but we have seen similar patterns, again, using evidence from other charities, no longer my day job, prices going up by 40% and some being sold in Scotland for several thousands. And we've seen a doubling of seizures of cats across the UK border. So that is a UK-wide, and of course, those trade and transport routes need to be joined up to avoid loopholes. And just to give the sort of range of views on the chipping, I think there is a broad consensus on the value of chipping of cats and the importance of that, as much as for dogs, from the cat's perspective at least. And obviously there are issues to solve, e.g. databases, and they need solving. That doesn't preclude the value of microchipping cats. So we need to have that compulsory microchipping and to sort out those issues. But again, that's me representing a range of views rather than a stalk view.
Convener, can I ask Dr. Boyden a question, please?
Yep, come in, Rachel.
Dr. Boyden, this is really interesting about strengthening the protections on animal welfare for pet trade and companion pets. And I just wondered if the examples that you give in terms of the data collection, whether that will be dealt with, it's James is making this point as well, on a UK-wide basis, or are there animals that are being imported into Scotland that we don't know about, that cannot be traced through a common objective or a common framework across the country? Does it need to be looked at from a devolved perspective and a UK-wide perspective? Can I ask Paula that, please?
Yes. Thank you for the question. The traceability is a really interesting and challenging area. So, in terms of particularly importation from overseas, I'm sure you're aware with the rules of the pet travel scheme that in order to travel, a cat or a dog or indeed a ferret needs to be microchipped, needs to be vaccinated against rabies, has to have a passport issued. Two big challenges with that. One is the microchip does not have to be registered on any database at all. So with no idea, so you could come across an individual with a microchip that won't be registered anywhere. The other challenge is that there is no traceability on entry to the country. And that gives me great concern. I saw the evidence that BVA had put forward, and I completely subscribe to it in terms of dogs, with regards to the risk of diseases coming into the country. What it would be ideal to see, apart from having a mandatory registration on a microchip database, is to actually log those microchip numbers on entry at whichever point of entry they come into. What that does is to give you a date stamp, and why that's important is that we have certainly seen, and we're aware that with dogs being imported, quite often the transporters will meet at Calais, they will divide the dogs between the various vehicles, and then they will literally travel up, for example, up the M1 corridor, probably north of the border as well. If we have a date stamp, if we do have an outbreak of disease, it starts to give us a level of risk. So if I can use the word rabies for a moment, most cases of rabies will present between 3 and 12 weeks post-infection. A dog that came into the country 6 months ago is going to be much lower risk than a dog that came into the country 6 weeks ago. So having that date stamp and having that microchip number, we know that individual has come through an approved route. It doesn't mean to say that everything is perfect, but it starts to give us that level of traceability. That is incredibly important. The other element, bringing it back to a more domestic level referring to your comments about looking at things from both a devolved and across all administrations. At the moment, in terms of the supply of dogs, obviously we've got the new LIRA regs that have come into effect. You only have to be licensed if you're producing three or more litters a year. So anybody producing less than two litters of dogs a year, there is zero traceability. Now, clearly, we don't want to be prohibitive. However, to have a system where there's at least registration, you start to get that traceability. But that registration, if it's with a local authority, it would mean there does need to be communications with the local authority so that you have a central repository in terms of the registrations and the licensing and the benefit of somebody. If for example, I had a dog, I was having a litter from them to have a registration number, that starts to give traceability in terms of me as an individual to make sure I'm not breaching the LIRA regs. But then it could also mean that if I'm advertising those puppies, I have to put that registration number on the advert, because this is where a lot of these illegally imported dogs are being advertised, is via online websites, and you've no idea who they are, where they've come from. So it starts to help with that. I'm not saying it's a panacea, but it starts to give us that traceability.
Thank you for that. Just in terms of the flow of the questions, can I bring in Jenny and then I'll come back to Ariane?
Thank you. I'd be interested to hear the views of SOC on the UK Animal Welfare Kept Animals Bill with respect to provisions on livestock exports, movement of domestic animals and modernisations of zoo licensing which apply to Scotland. Thank you.
Thank you. I think that there's obviously there's several different pieces in there, and I think we will probably pass the baton around a little bit. But I think some of the issues around the export and import of animals and trade issues, I think, were, and we would concur with those issues. And we talked about animal movements when we talked about those issues. You know, the responses to those are still well. So we would support moves to prevent or to reduce the export of live animals, particularly and purpose is slaughter. I think, as we've already talked about, there is overwhelming evidence that animal is a cause for welfare concern. We may not know everything about all aspects of the journey, but it's very clear that there's welfare compromise through animal transport. So we would be supportive of moves to ban live exports. The issue of zoo license. Can I pass that one to you? And I've forgotten the other part of the question. So it was exports, zoo licensing and...
Movement of domestic animals.
Movement of domestic animals, thank you. Okay. Libby, would you pick up zoo licensing?
With difficulty, frankly. I'm aware that it's a fairly small clause in the bill, so much of that will depend on the standards, Secretary of State standards, which I understand are to be made mandatory. And I watched our fellow Commission member, Simon Girling, speaking on this. He's been very involved with developing these standards and clearly feels that they are robust. So I'm pretty sure the SOC will be in favour of those. It's also necessary for zoos to demonstrate a conservation purpose, which I think is another valuable protection for the animals. I did hear yesterday in the committee looking at the bill that you can't treat all zoos the same, so small collections versus a large international standard zoo like Edinburgh Zoo. But I think probably we would be better to speak to Simon Girling and respond to you in writing on that one.
That's a good suggestion. Thank you, Libby.
Okay. Can I move on to Ariane, please?
Thank you, Convener. I want to touch on the UK Animal Welfare Sentience Bill, which has provisions to create an Animal Sentience Committee to advise the UK Secretary of State. And I'd like to know how SOC might engage with a future animal with this committee in future, if it comes to be, and what your views are on the provisions in place in Scotland to have regard to animal sentience, especially given that Article 13 of the Treaty on the Functioning of the EU, which stipulates that full regard should be paid to animals' welfare requirements when formulating and implementing policy, no longer applies. Maybe Libby?
Thank you. Yes, and I think a very important question, and I think a key part of our of the setting up of SAWC is animal sentience. That's a sort of keystone part of our deliberations, our thinking, and our approaches. So I think, and we would support an approach that makes it clear in legislation that that particular groups of animals, and we've already talked a little bit about which ones those might be, are considered to be sentient, and that takes animals into a different place. They're not considered as a tradable good in the same way, or a commodity in the same way that something that is inanimate might be considered. And we think that is really important. And I think in my opening statement, we also talked about how sentience should be considered as an important part of policy making, and not just the policies that relate specifically to animals, but in other areas as well. That this is something that that we feel as SAWC is really a key part of our remit, is to keep that in mind, both in the work that we do that's directly related to animals, but also thinking about other impacts, other aspects of the programme, Food Nation as well, and procurement, that when we think about food, animal sentience is really an important part of that, which is sometimes not always considered. And there are, of course, other parts of legislation where I think Libby has already referred to thinking about regulation, but not necessarily thinking about animal welfare when we have sentient animals involved. In terms of the proposal to set up a sentience committee, and I think that potentially is going to be part of the Animal Welfare Committee. Within SAWC, we have a slightly different remit in that we're independent in a way that the Animal Welfare, we do engage with the Animal Welfare Committee on a regular basis, so we're aware of what they're working on, and I would expect that that would also extend to the Animal Sentience Committee when that is set up. Within SAWC itself, we are setting up our own sort of subgroup, I suppose, to deal specifically with animal sentience and some of the ethical issues that arise in that, to help the wider deliberations of SAWC. So recognising animal sentience is really a key part of what we do as SAWC, and we would expect to also be engaging in the same way that we currently are with the Animal Welfare Committee on any developments relating to their sentience committee. James, who is leading our work on animal sentience, did you have anything that you...
I heard Cathy up to, did you have anything that you... So I'm going to imagine the rest of the sentence and respond. Apologies if I've got it wrong. So, in terms of the bill, I think what we've been talking about recognising sentience is that first step. And as we were discussing earlier, that recognition then can lead to assessments alongside other considerations, of course, in policy making. And as I say, quite often it might well be that they are aligned with other environmental or health or other concerns, or even productivity concerns. The Sentience Committee, as I understand it, in the UK is also having a role in ensuring government policy considers animal sentience, whereas here for SAWC we are not taking that sort of quite such a strong view. We're giving advice and helping and assisting policy making. Again, yourselves or Libby might be able to explain that better, but that does mean there's a slightly different role here. What we can do to help is to make sure is that that consideration is based on good science, is done objectively and robustly, and that draws in all the relevant expertise and issues. We can also help, and this is on the subcommittee we're setting up, working out ways to prioritise what are the most important ways to consider that sentience, as well as then obviously how you do that in policy making. Obviously, part of that is going to be related to sentience in terms of which species are sentient, how severe the suffering would be, but also, of course, is going to take into account wider issues in terms of legislative agenda, of course. In terms of the linking up to AWC, again, I think there are links already in place, particularly across CARES and at least one co-member, although that's an informal link, and I think officials do too, that would set up similarly, I'd assume, for the Animal Sentience Committee. But until we know what that looks like, it's quite hard to define what that relationship would be. But it would be important to be having that relationship to avoid duplication and, where appropriate, to align.
Thank you, James. I'm conscious that we're running out of time, as always happens in these evidence sessions, and I've got two members who still haven't been able to ask the question. So could I move on to the theme of the EU exit and bring in Rachel Hamilton, please?
Thank you. I'll try and make it nice and succinct. Our exit from the EU could bring challenges and opportunities. It's an opportunity for us to strengthen animal welfare, but I'd like to know from the panel where you believe the deficiencies are currently at, and in terms of strengthening animal welfare, things like welfare labelling, ending sow stalls, possibly bringing in gene editing to ensure that we increase biodiversity. You talked about livestock, livestock transport. Where are the issues? What are the most important priorities that we should be looking at? Should I start with Professor Dwyer? You seem to be managing the panel very well.
Well, thank you very much for the compliment. And I'm struggling a little bit with connectivity issues, so I'm doing my best in difficult circumstances. I'm happy to make a start on this one, and I will probably, if time permits, it would be useful to get inputs from everybody. It's not something we've specifically discussed as SAWC, so we don't have a SAWC view on this. I think it's probably more a personal view, which reflects our areas of expertise and interests. I think from you mentioned a number of different areas that I think are significant concerns. Live transport and export, I think we've already talked about. Non-stun slaughter is something that it still rears its head, I think. It's still an issue in the EU as well as here. And I think there is moves to strengthen that legislation to ensure end of life. But I think certainly that there is a strong driver in the EU at the moment to get rid of cages altogether, including farrowing stalls for sows. And that would be something that it would be good to see Scotland and the UK also contributing to. I think there's mounting evidence and indeed sort of consumer and citizen pressure for that to occur. It's not without its problems, of course, both from a welfare point of view. There is a growing body of evidence to say that these sorts of confinement systems are just not what people want. I think animal welfare labelling is a really interesting issue. Before we left Brexit, I used to sit on the EU Animal Welfare Platform, and we did discuss animal welfare labelling there as well. And it's not without its issues in terms of what can be put on a label that is meaningful for consumers in terms of their understanding of animal welfare. And we do put a lot of pressure on consumers to make the right choice. And I think that's going to be, particularly if we think about some of the trade agreements that we might make with countries where we know there is poorer animal welfare standards, and how that might affect people's buying behavior. And it's potentially successful if you're buying shell eggs, if you're buying a piece of meat, but it's much more difficult if you're buying a ready-prepared sandwich, where you might not think about the life the chicken had in your chicken sandwich or in fast food restaurants, where animal welfare labelling is potentially not as useful. So I think there is particular issues around new trade agreements with countries The USA would be an obvious one, but there are also issues with Australia and New Zealand and some of their welfare practices, which are poorer than what we currently have in the UK and in Europe. So I think that there are lots of probably an area that's quite the informal management procedures in farmed animals and what. So I think from a farmed point of view, there is a number of issues and that might be opportunities, but I think our particular challenges as well and what sort of trade agreements we might make with other countries for farmed animals in terms of their welfare. I'm sure that Pete has and Libby will have things to say about wildlife, so maybe we can move to them and then to talk about companion animals.
Okay, shall I pick up, Cathy? But just to reiterate those points that you made, we certainly have aspirations to be a society that pays high regard to animal welfare, but sometimes purchasing behaviour doesn't follow that lead. So there's a big educational role here, I think, to play, to put in place, and that relates to people of all ages, really, in terms of what the systems mean. The labelling issue is a critical one, but, you know, most consumers zoom through the supermarket and just snatch things as they go. Taking time to look at a label that tells you about a carbon footprint, the calorific value of the food, and as well as that, some animal welfare notation is going to be very difficult. And supermarkets are struggling with this. And as you say, Cathy, there's a super big problem in terms of processed food where there are many components. Looking at the food miles on those components even is a difficult one, and if there are animal welfare aspects as well, that's very important. But of course, if we're trying to play on a global market as a nation, we can't fall behind the standards of the lead players, but there's a cost implication of us being ahead of the game. And so there's a lot of economics that comes into this too. But I think there are, as you alluded to, Cathy, there are some good opportunities in terms of leading the way in how we interact with wildlife. And the growing awareness of everyone about the sentience debate, if you like, and how that's falling into people's minds is very important. And I think this really kickstarts probably the work that the Scottish Government is doing and was in the last programme for government to publish a strategic approach to wildlife management that puts animal welfare in the centre. And I'm not quite sure how that work is being taken forward, but it's a really exciting area. It could be a world-leading area for Scotland, and it could deal with lots of the concerns that we've already covered today in that lots of the way we approach the management of wildlife is fragmented. There are numerous rules, regulations, objectives of different players. There needs to be a consensus to bring everyone together here. And I'm really looking forward to this strategic approach that's being worked on at the moment. And as I say, that could be a great step for harmonisation and a world-leading aspect of the way Scotland manages its wildlife. So that's a very exciting opportunity for us, I think.
Thank you. I've got a brief supplementary from Jim Fairley.
Convener, just a point rather than anything else at the moment about the labelling. A consumer takes 6 seconds to make a decision from seeing a product to putting it in their basket. I was at a meeting last night where they were talking about labelling for environmental standards, welfare standards, hygiene standards, nutritional standards. We're going to ask people to be taking 5 hours a day to go and do their shopping with the amount of labelling that we're looking at, and it is a real issue and we need to find a solution for it. But in terms of the EU relationship, following an appearance on the 29th of September, Simon Turner raised that there may be merit in creating a Scottish Animal Welfare Reference Centre, given the fact that we have lost access to the EU's notification system by coming out of the EU. What do the panel feel about a centre? Is there merit in creating a Scottish Animal Welfare Resource Centre to support the Commission's work through working together, literature identity and research gaps and training needs.
Can I bring in Paula Boyden on this one?
Sorry, should I say something? I can't see who's going to take the lead on. So thanks for the question. That's a really good question. Actually, I looked at the EU Reference Centre the website quite recently. There is some information there, and it's a sort of work in progress, I guess, for many of the species. There's quite a lot of information on pigs, but for many of the species, there isn't a lot. I didn't see any coverage of, if you like, non-production animals either, and that's perhaps a shortcoming of it. I think there's a lot of merit in having a system that meets the Scottish need. It wouldn't be without resource implications, but following on from Simon Turner's comments, I think it's something that should seriously be looked at, and in a way that perhaps could go hand in hand with the thoughts about having a Scottish-centred veterinary service as well. So I think there could be some merits in combining a lot of these things together to be able to deliver something that's more tailored to the needs of Scotland going forward.
And did Paula want to come in on?
Yeah. Yes, please, if I may, just in terms of companion animals obviously as exiting the EU. I think we are starting to see some benefits. You'll obviously be aware that the Kept Animals Bill is going through Westminster at the moment. The rules surrounding pet travel, whether they're commercial or non-commercial, is basically EU legislation. So prior to exiting the EU, irrespective of which side of the fence you sit on regarding EU exit, it now has presented an opportunity for us to change the law. With regards to the Kept Animals Bill, there's a proposal to increase the minimum age of dogs entering the UK, a decrease in the stage of pregnancy of a pregnant female dog before they can the maximum in terms of them coming in, a ban on mutilations. Importation of dogs with mutilations, i.e. with those that are either docked or have cropped ears, and the number of animals as well. So they are really positive steps forward. I mean, clearly the devil is in the detail, but the other thing I would say about that is, as with any legislation, it's only as good as its enforcement. So it's really important that we are able to harness these in terms of making sure that the legislation is robust, but making sure that our colleagues who are enforcing do actually have the knowledge, the skills and the resources to enforce those. There's another piece of legislation that does apply to companion animals, but not greatly, and that's the welfare of animals in transport. DEFRA consulted on EC1 2005, the relevant piece of legislation, but unfortunately very much focused on food producing animals. But again, there is an opportunity there to just look at that and input into it from a companion animal perspective as well.
Thank you for that. Before I bring in Karen, can I bring back Rachel?
Yeah, thank you. With regards to what Scotland can provide in terms of veterinary checks, phytosanitary checks and others, including managing biosecurity, do you have any views on what we should be doing to protect I suppose animal welfare but also biosecurity on imported goods coming into Scotland, and what Scotland can do to ensure that is of the highest standard and we have the highest capacity and capability to do that? Maybe Pete.
Well, thank you. Thank you for the question. It's probably a resource issue as much as anything else in a way. And it also relates to actually the points on the border where goods enter. So there may be, it depends whether you take a Scottish or a UK or GB wide view about where the point of entry is and whether there are checks along the way elsewhere, but I'm afraid I'm not an expert in this particular area, so I guess that's something we would need to come back to you about.
Okay, thank you.
So that's something you could provide a written response to, perhaps. that would be helpful. Finally, can I bring in Karen Adam, who's joining us remotely?
Just wondered if everybody can hear and see me. Okay, that's great. Thank you, convener. I have two questions, if I may, but obviously I'll take your lead and if there's time for the second question. But my first question, really, I'd like to ask about the complex connection between animal abuse and domestic violence, particularly as we've seen recently in the pandemic context. Numerous studies have confirmed that in households with companion animals experiencing domestic violence and abuse, there is also a high probability of animal abuse. So some domestic reports detail that individuals and families will often delay fleeing a violent situation due to concerns regarding the safety of their companion animal. What more can be done, as children in particular often rely on their pet to provide stability, security and companionship? And I ask this from a veterinary and animal welfare agency context, as they may be in a position to identify this, as holistic approaches to abuse issues have a greater impact overall. Thank you.
Bring in Paula.
The question is incredibly pertinent, because we know that, particularly during lockdown, that domestic homicides actually increased quite significantly. I do declare an interest here. I am actually chair of the Links Group, which is a multi-agency group that basically acts to raise awareness of the links between violence to people and violence to animals. And I think that there's two elements to your question. One is to continue to encourage that interagency working. One of the things that my own organisation does alongside other members of the Links Group is to actually provide temporary fostering for pets belonging to people fleeing domestic abuse. And that's really important for two reasons. One is that, as you quite rightly say, we know that individuals will delay fleeing a violent situation because they don't want to leave the pet behind at the hands of the perpetrator. And the other is, I think, particularly for the children who, they are the, they may not know everything that is going on, but to actually be able to give them that lifeline that once they're out of that situation, once they're in a better place, then they will be reunited with their pets is significant. Certainly with a lot of the pet fostering, that there will be regular updates for the client and their children about how their pet is getting on. I can't tell you the importance and the value of those to those individuals in that situation. The other side, if I can put my vet's hat on for a moment, is really continuing to raise awareness within the profession about identifying what is so-called non-accidental or deliberate injuries. This is all based on the work that was undertaken by Helen Monroe back 20 years ago. She published some research where we have good diagnostic indicators for abuse of animals, and it will come to no surprise to you that those indicators are exactly the same if you're dealing with abuse of a child. So we are working incredibly hard to raise awareness of non-accidental injury and identifying it within the veterinary profession. So we're now speaking at most of the UK vet schools, including Edinburgh and Glasgow, on an annual basis to raise awareness amongst the students. I think one of the other big things with that is that within the Royal College of Veterinary Surgeons, our governing body, there is specific guidance within the Code of Professional Conduct, basically one covering that if you have an animal with injuries that you can't explain them, that you should consider non-accidental injury. But more importantly, particularly in this world of GDPR, that if animal welfare or the public interest is compromised, we can breach client confidentiality. So you cannot hide behind client confidentiality if you have concerns. As I'm sure you can appreciate, these are incredibly challenging cases to deal with. It's not an A plus B equals C in terms of the injuries, and also going through that process of reporting a non-accidental injury to the SSPCA to be able to signpost a client to the resources they can get help from are incredibly challenging. So we do need to continue to raise awareness, and certainly, again, with my Links hat on, we are sitting on a group that's been convened by Scottish SPCA to push this forward, to raise awareness amongst the vet schools, raise that education. So that's, you know, incredibly important that we continue to do that, but also providing those resources on the ground. And I think with my experience with the Lynx group, sometimes we do have challenges with our human health professional colleagues if they don't understand the bond, if they don't understand the importance of the human-animal bond between an owner and their pet. They may not understand the importance of why somebody will delay fleeing a violent situation. So it's really important we continue to work with other colleagues, other agencies, so we do have a multi-agency approach to these cases.
Thank you, Paula. Karen, did you want to come back in with another question?
Yes, thank you. And I'm grateful for that answer. And I think it's extremely important to have that multi-agency approach. And I'm glad to hear that there is ongoing work in that regards. And I just want to come back in on the pandemic theme. We've seen an increase in pet ownership, but also a consequence of this was an increase of people diversifying into self-employed animal-based work, such as grooming, training, and pet sitting and walking. And just to quickly give an anecdote, for example, I took my dog to a groomer, which I won't name. She was connected to a high table with a lead. The groomer stepped away from the table and my dog jumped off. And luckily I was there just in time to scoop her up, or the consequences could have been quite horrific. The lead had no safety break, and surely policy would be not to leave the dog unattended. This and issues that I've heard regarding bad training practices have been highlighted. Are there any kind of regulations that we can see coming forward for these businesses popping up, and any support for those with genuine experience who have worked incredibly hard to ensure their high standards, which may be undermined and undercut in price? Are the regulations tight enough? And how can the public be aware of what certification, for example, they should be looking for when using these businesses?
Thank you for the question. It's incredibly pertinent, and I think you've touched on a number of issues there. If we look at training and behaviour, first of all, there is no regulation of the world of training and behaviour at all, and that is something that, as a commission, we are currently looking at, particularly the use of things like aversive training devices, so electronic shock collars, check chains, these sorts of things. So we are looking at that, but it is an area that really does need reviewing and potentially regulation in terms of the behaviour side of things. Again, with my vet's hat on, there are very, very few veterinary behaviourists across the country, but that needs to be separated from the training side of things. And over the years, we know there's been a huge move towards training by reward and reinforcement rather than by punishment. So that really does need looking at, and I think the other areas that you've mentioned, things like dog walking has grown enormously, dog grooming has grown enormously. Excuse me. Personally, with, if I may just drop south of the border with my canine and feline sector group hat on for a moment, we have produced some guidelines for dog walkers, but they are very much guidelines. But given the size of the industry now, and similarly with grooming, I think it is something that does need looking at. So as you quite rightly say, that there is good advice for pet owners in how do I find a good groomer, a good dog walker, what should I be looking for, and that the regulation and as you say, the expertise that is there, it is recognised.
Thank you. Did I see Cathy's hand up? Yeah. Cathy, do you want to come in?
Yes, thank you. I mean, I would reiterate everything that Paula said, of course. I think also this is on our sort of longer term plan, is to agree that these are important. And I would also expand that beyond beyond dogs. Actually, we've also talked about this in terms of managing equine establishments and people who also offer services, which again are similarly unregulated, and perhaps haven't, that things have with the pandemic, but nonetheless these are on our radar, if you like, for the medium to longer term in terms of consideration.
Thank you for that response. Karen, has that answered your questions? Yeah. Okay, thank you. That brings us to the end of this evidence session. I thank the witnesses for their evidence, and we will now briefly suspend and come back at 11:45. We turn now to agenda item 2, the European Union Withdrawal Act 2018. I refer members to paper 2. The Official Controls Transitional Staging Period Miscellaneous Amendments Scotland No. 2 Regulations 2021 are made using powers under the EU Withdrawal Act 2018. Under the protocol between the Scottish Parliament and the Scottish Government, the committee is required to consider whether the procedure attached to the SSI is appropriate or should be changed. The instrument is subject to the negative procedure, and Scottish ministers have categorised this instrument as low significance, as the amendments are solely to make relatively minor amendments to the transitional arrangements in place. The DPLR committee considered the instrument at its meeting on 26 October and agreed the negative procedure was appropriate. Is the committee content that the negative procedure is appropriate for this instrument? Yeah. Thank you, members. We move on to agenda item 3. I refer members to papers 2 and 3. As the committee has agreed the negative procedure is appropriate, we will now consider the policy intent of the Official Controls Transitional Staging Period Miscellaneous Amendments Scotland No. 2 Regulations 2021. Members will recall the committee wrote to the Scottish Government regarding previous subordinate legislation relating to import checks following our meeting on 6 October. A response was received yesterday and has been circulated to members as well as published on our web pages. The convener has indicated that the committee will consider the letter further at next week's meeting. Does any member wish to raise any issues regarding this instrument? No. Are members content to note the instrument? Yeah. I now refer members to paper 4. The committee is invited to consider the Fish Farming Code of Practice Scotland Order 2021, which is also subject to the negative procedure. Does any member wish to raise any issues regarding this instrument?
I would like to make a note. I want to note that the consultation analysis shows that most of the individuals, environmental organisations and fisheries or other boards, trust respondents who supported the code would like fish farms to be regulated further and are also concerned about enforcement of implementation of the code. Concerns about regulation included several requests that the code do more to manage and control or phase out acoustic deterrent devices and replace them with benign methods of predator control. Concerns about enforcement included concerns around non-compliance and inconsistency of self-reporting by APBs, concerns about inadequate penalties for non-compliance, and challenges regarding the practicalities of implementing the code, including timescales, content of reporting, and gaps in contradictory guidance. Several respondents indicated that their view that more of the code should be in the form of mandatory requirements rather than guidance. We need to ensure that fish farms are operating sustainably in order for them to continue providing jobs and benefits for coastal communities for the long term. So I'm content to note the instrument, but I urge the government to review the code on a regular basis and update it as necessary to ensure that use of best available practice underpinned by scientific findings and new developments.
Thank you. That is noted. Are members content to note the instrument? Yeah. And then agenda item 4, the European Union Withdrawal Act 2018. I refer members to papers 5 and 6. The committee will consider a proposal by the Scottish Government to consent to the UK Government legislating using the powers under the Act in relation to the following UK statutory instrument, the Waste and Agriculture Legislative Functions Regulations 2021. As this SI notification cuts across a number of policy areas and addresses legislative deficiencies across three ministerial portfolios, this committee will only focus on the agricultural legislative functions. The other functions are being considered by the Net Zero Energy and Transport Committee and the Local Government Housing and Planning Committee. Under the protocol between the Scottish Parliament and Scottish Government, the consent notification has been categorised as Type 1, meaning the Scottish Parliament's agreement is sought before the Scottish Government gives consent to the UK Government making secondary legislation in devolved competence. Does any member wish to raise an issue with this consent notification? No. Is the committee content that the agricultural provision set out in the notification should be included in a UKSI? Yep. Is the committee content to delegate authority to me to sign off a letter to the Scottish Government informing them of our decision today and to confirm that no SSIs were made under the defective power this SI seeks to correct? Thank you. That brings this meeting to a close.